So I want to invite Dr. Sara Combs up to the podium. And Anastasi will be able to help us get her slides going. As Kate O'Malley pointed out, we have extensive bios here for you to reach and read. And because we have very little time, I'm going to just share with you the essential factors, so to speak, of the bios. Dr. Sara Combs is a nephrologist. She went to medical school at the University of Washington, where she stayed to do her residency in internal medicine, for which she received a leadership award. She went on to do a fellowship in nephrology at the University of Colorado, where her research focused on improving palliative and end-of-life care to patients with chronic kidney disease. Her primary research project was a cross-sectional national survey of nephrology fellows regarding their end-of-life training and fellowship. In 2013, she was invited to participate in the Kidney Disease Improving Global Outcomes Controversies Conference in Renal Support Care in Mexico City. And upon completion of her nephrology fellowship, she returned to the University of Washington, where she is currently a fellow in palliative care. And so she will be looking at our topic today from both sides. Thank you very much, Sara, for coming down from U of Washington.
So, as she said, I am a nephrologist, and I'm also in the middle of undergoing a palliative care fellowship. And so I'm really excited to talk with you guys about little sort of things that I've picked up along the way that have become apparent to me. That has really kind of enlightened my view of how to approach medicine in patients with kidney disease. So I'll go through objectives, and I understand we have a bit of a mixed audience here, so I think I have something for everyone, and so just stick around with me if I'll get to something that will be helpful to you. So I'm going to start with the basics and define palliative medicine, and this is a shared decision-making conference, so I'm going to define shared decision-making. Discuss strategies for effective shared decision-making specific to CKD and ESRD patients. Describe when and how to incorporate palliative care services into nephrology practice. And then talk about some renal-specific clinical scenarios in which effective shared decision-making is important. And then I'm going to talk a little bit, just introduce some communication strategies, which in the breakout groups you'll have the opportunity to actually use in practice, and then to identify when and how palliative medicine might be helpful. So just very briefly, people mentioned when I told them I'd be doing this talk that it might be interesting to see how I came to do both nephrology and palliative care. So I started in medical school. I actually did a rotation in palliative care and totally fell in love because it was the first time where I felt like we were actually like spending time with the patients and listening to their story. And I also knew very much that I liked nephrology. So after internal medicine training, going through nephrology fellowship, I remember feeling very sort of sad because I didn't have the time to spend to talk with my patients and get to know kind of what their values and goals were. And I feel like I didn't have the tools that I needed to help communicate with them better. And so that's what helped me decide to go ahead and do another fellowship in nephrology or in palliative medicine. So this is me during nephrology fellowship using my defense mechanism of being goofy so that I can get through some of the stressful times. And then more of a motivator recently, you know, in my life is I've dealt with a lot of unfortunate sort of family experiences with some health problems. And as you experience medicine and sort of the, you know, family role and caretaker role, it definitely is a huge motivator. I think every day as I, you know, practice medicine to think of what that experience is like so that I can provide better care to patients. So this is a picture of my grandmother after. She fell and bonked her head and got a concussion, and everything's kind of spiraled after that. So that's a, you know, kind of been a problem that I've been dealing with recently on a personal level. So palliative medicine, I'll just talk about how I personally view it as in definitions of philosophy, and then people talk about primary, secondary, and tertiary palliative care. So people always talk about sort of a palliative approach to medicine, and what they're sort of talking about is essentially providing, you know, quality patient-centered healthcare to patients with serious illness. And this is essentially eliciting patients' goals and values, providing care that's in line with those values, and then communicating sort of what's to come and expectations for the future. Involved in that is eliciting and managing symptoms, and then eliciting and addressing emotional and spiritual distress. So people have been talking about the need of primary palliative care because there are not going to be enough palliative medicine doctors to take care of all of these issues. And that essentially refers to basic skills in the sort of palliative medicine that all providers should feel comfortable using. Secondary palliative medicine is perhaps what is most referred to most commonly is the sort of subspecialty care that's provided. And that defined as a specialized medical care for people with serious illnesses. It's typically a multidisciplinary sort of team of physicians, providers, nurse practitioners, physician assistants, nurses, spiritual care, social workers, chaplains, volunteers. And the goal is to help, you know, provide an extra layer of support while people are going through their illness. The goal also is to improve quality of life. It's focused on providing patients with relief from symptoms, pain, and stress of a serious illness. And it's important to emphasize that this is appropriate for any age and any stage in a serious illness. And it can be and is best if provided together with curative treatment. So common reasons that we get consulted in palliative care is clarification of patient family goals for pain, symptom management, emotional, social, and spiritual support, and figuring out the next steps. This slide is just to emphasize that palliative care does many things, and one of which is hospice, but hospice is not the only thing that we do. We do it well, but there are other things that we help with. And so a lot of people associate palliative care with sort of end-of-life care and hospice care, but we do many other things. And this is just sort of put a picture to how palliative care is best delivered. Primarily, you know, at the beginning of the diagnosis of an illness, and then sort of increasing our services as needed as somebody's the disease progresses until death. So the models of subspecialty palliative care, so they're it's provided on inpatient consultation service. I think that's probably what most people are familiar with. There are outpatient palliative care services. Which can be either sort of a subspecialty clinic that's on its own, or some outpatient palliative care providers actually go to the home and do these services, depending on where you are. And then there are sort of this subset of integrated or palliative care clinics, or what's referred to as tertiary palliative care, where essentially the, providers are put into clinics of serious, some type of illness. So like for cancer or end-stage renal disease, where providers are essentially there and are working in hand with those other subspecialty services. So the benefits, there's been many studies that show that palliative medicine improves quality of healthcare delivered by improving quality of life, symptom control, patient family satisfaction, and then also that the survival of patients using palliative care has been shown to be the same or improved from those who are receiving regular care, and that it does lower healthcare costs by decreasing healthcare utilization. So moving on to talking about shared decision making, I feel like it's reasonable to define what it is. And this is the definition from the Informed Medical Decision Making Foundation. It's a collaborative process that allows patients and their providers to make healthcare decisions together, taking into account the best scientific evidence available, as well as the patient's values and practices. And I think that's coming along about and thinking about shared decision making. The things that I've learned myself, and I think that is something that's worth pointing out, is that medical decision making should not be done in isolation. So it's really important to involve patients, surrogate decision makers, when you're talking about some of these complex medical decisions. Decisions that we make with our patients should never be considered something that is a decision that's forever and that will not change. You know, people, as they progress through their illness, they change what they want, and so often we need to say, hey, how are things going? Let's talk about the previous decision that we made before. And then lastly, I know how hard it is to talk about these things, and especially in a time-pressed environment. I think that's what everyone could identify as the number one sort of barrier to having these conversations. The one thing that we have an advantage in sort of the ESRD setting and CKD setting is that we have time to take, generally have time to take to talk about these things. And so these conversations, they don't have to be an hour or two long conversation. They can do in tidbits over time over multiple visits. So the topics that are ripe for shared decision making in patients with CKD, deciding about renal replacement therapy, whether that be transplant, dialysis, etc. Choosing between renal replacement therapy and non-dialytic management of kidney disease, choosing modality and access, talking about advanced care planning in terms of sort of advanced directives, surrogate decision makers and code status, and then deciding to stop dialysis. And then I thought I'd point out opportunities of communicating and reconfirming sort of decisions that have been made before. And I think the times to be thinking about that is, if somebody's disease is progressing, if somebody's initiating dialysis, and then any time that a person, essentially with end-stage renal disease, has an acute illness, something called like a sentinel event where they're in the hospital, they have a cardiac event, they've had an infection, they've started on dialysis. Of course, whenever a patient or family requests, and then any time that you've noticed a clear decline in the patient's medical functional status. And example of that would be, I just saw a gentleman a couple days ago who's like 45 and has end-stage renal disease from AA amyloid. And I saw him a month ago and he had lost 15 pounds and he looked a lot worse than the last time I saw him. So I said to myself, he's definitely declining and it's need to readdress some of this other stuff that we talked about before. So why is shared decision making important? I think that's may seem like an obvious question, but I think it should be asked. And the reason is because there are studies that are coming up over and over again that show that people are not receiving the care that they say that they would want to have. And they're also saying that people feel unprepared for what's to come and they don't know what's going on with their illness. So we need to make sure that we match patient preferences with the care that we provide to them. So a couple of studies that I just wanted to point out that, again, patients are feeling unprepared for what to expect in the future. People feel shocked about when they're experiencing the illness, about what they're actually undergoing. They had no idea that this was going to happen to them. A lot of patients feel like they have no choice about starting dialysis, that's just that they have to start dialysis. And then many patients have perceived that the decision of starting dialysis has been made before them prior to discussing it in person. So Sara Davison in Alberta, Canada, had a survey several years ago where she talked to her patients on hemodialysis, and the results that came out of that have always been sort of shocking to me. The survey showed that 61% of patients regretted the decision to start on dialysis. Very few patients felt informed about their medical condition and how it might change over time. 85% of patients thought it was very or extremely or somewhat important to be informed about this. And then, when talking about preferences, 36% of patients prefer to die at home and 27% prefer to die in a hospital. And when we talk about matching care with what patient preferences are, we know that it's not happening. This is from Susan Wong at the UW where I'm at. And this is a study that they looked at all Medicare beneficiaries that are on dialysis, have cancer and heart failure, and looked at the intensity of care that they received during the final month of their life. And so you can see dialysis patients, 45% of dialysis patients are dying in a hospital, 20% are using hospice, and then 49% of dialysis patients are in the ICU during the last month of life, and compared the numbers on cancer and heart failure and see that these are really different. These are, you know, huge numbers. This always takes my breath away when I see this slide. So I think that's, these are the reasons that the American Board of Maternal Medicine worked with the American Society of Nephrology on their five things physicians and patients should question on this choosing wisely campaign. And, you know, the fifth sort of question is, you know, not initiating dialysis without ensuring the shared decision-making process between patients and their family and their physicians. So when talking about shared decision-making, I honestly think I only recently began to understand what that meant, because the way that I saw shared decision-making modeled in medical school and residency and fellowship is essentially a bunch of facts being spewed out to the patient and their family, and then us expecting them to tell us what they want. And that doesn't work. And the reason that doesn't work is because most people are not medical providers, and we can't expect people to make these complex medical decisions without our guidance. And so I think it's important to point out that everyone in the shared decision making has a role. The patients and the family, their role is to provide their values and their preferences. And then as providers, our role is to help provide information about treatments that are indicated, and then help guide the family in making decisions based on what their values and preferences are. I'm going to skip over that slide really quick, but this is data from the critical care setting from Randy Curtis at UW, but he has done a lot of research on shared decision making and how it is approached in the general setting. And this is just to show sort of the different sort of the extremes at which decision making can happen. And one end, he calls it parentalism, I think, because he doesn't want to use the word paternalism. And then the other, autonomy, and saying that shared decision making is somewhere in the middle. But it seems when we've looked at all the research of how this is done, people go sort of back and forth. And I think that that's really appropriate. But the interesting thing is that most providers sort of stay one place where they're sort of comfortable with the service decision-making process, and they don't kind of change according to what the patients and the family sort of saying that they want. So it's a reminder that sometimes it's okay to sort of make recommendations, and sometimes if a family member and a patient seems like they're kind of wanting more of an autonomous process, then we should sort of value that. So when you're talking about these difficult medical decisions, how do you know what role the patient and family wants you to play? Well, I think that it's sort of, you just listen to them, you use what you know about them from previous interactions. If they've, if they've been the kind of person that said, hey, I really think that it'd be nice to know what you think, doc, then you kind of need to help guide them. And if they're the people that, just want the information and make the decision, then that's okay. Listen to their decision-making style, explore statements about how they've made decisions in previous situations, and then sort of generate hypotheses for their role. Say, last time, when we talked about this, this seemed to me that you were kind of a guy who likes statistics. Is that, am I getting that right? And then they can say yeah or no. So I'm going to go over some really basic cases, and I hope that they illustrate two things. Number one, that again, these decisions are things that are probably best done in short little snippets of time for multiple reasons, and that this can be done effectively. And number two, just to kind of illustrate some communication strategies which you'll have the opportunity to use later on in the day, but how they might happen in a real setting. So this is a case, Mr. Rodriguez, he's a 54-year-old man, Mexican-American man with diabetic nephropathy. He's in clinic. You've known him on and off for 2 years. You've shared time with him, with other providers. His blood pressure and diabetes is now well controlled, and his kidney disease continues to progress. And
now has an estimated glomerular filtration rate of 24 milliliters per minute less, and then 2.5 grams of proteinuria. And this essentially meaning that his kidney disease is getting worse. This is for the providers out there just to see. This is kind of how we like to look at how kidney disease is declining. This is his serum creatinine over a period of time. And then a couple things that you know about him: he's married, his wife often comes to visits, he doesn't say much, but clearly is involved in his healthcare. They have two children, they're teenagers, he works full time, and you know that he really enjoys riding his motorcycle. So you've decided, you know, I've done a really good job of taking care of this guy, his blood pressure is controlled, his diabetes is controlled, but unfortunately, you know, he's progressing, and I need to talk to him about what's to come in the future. And today's a good time because we have an extra 10, 15 minutes. And so introducing sort of a tool that is common to use in sort of helping guide communication, this ask-tell-ask tool. And I think that it's the importance of the tools essentially to illustrate that we need to let the patients and their families talk to us so that we can hear what they know and then how to sort of guide treatment and guide information according to what their understanding is. So that first gap, the first ask is assessing the patient's perceptions and preferences. The tell is telling the information, and the second ask is checking in that you understand. So starting with this first ask, the goals are, you know, to assess, to sort of invite the conversation to happen, see if they're ready to talk, to understand what they get, what they already know, and then to negotiate how information will be given. So when we're inviting ourselves, the point of this is to prepare the patient and their family for the discussion. You're not going to get anywhere talking about something if someone's not ready to do so. They're just going to, everything's going to kind of go beyond them, and the whole conversation is going to be pointless. So it's important to ask people if they're ready to talk about some of these heavy issues. And it gives them a sense of control and a place where they're feeling less in control in their lives. So in this situation, he says, you know, doc, I'm worried because my numbers keep getting worse. And then you say, yeah, I'm also worried. Is it okay if we spend a little time today talking about this and what to expect? And then he says, yes, he gives you the red light. The second ask is figuring out what somebody understands. It allows you to know what they know and their perspective, and it facilitates conversation. And this is really important because when someone is talking in the presence of other family members or what their community is, it's a really great way for them to kind of talk to each other and figure out like what they know and to sort of invite other commentary into this. So you'd say, you know, before we do that, it would really help for me to hear from you what you know about what's going on with your kidneys and how they're functioning. He says, well, I know my numbers keep getting worse and my kidneys are just getting worse. I don't understand because I feel like I've done everything I can. I'm worried about needing dialysis. My cousin was on dialysis and he hated it. I can't go to dialysis 3 days a week. I have to support my family. And so you found out things that you didn't know before. What you found out was that he knows that he is going to have to need dialysis in the future, or he's going to need some sort of renal replacement therapy in the future. So you don't have to tell him that. You know, he already knows. He's worried about his financial stability, and he has an unfavorable impression of dialysis. So this gives you the information to sort of tailor therapy. You don't want to give this guy options of doing in-center hemodialysis in the middle of the day when he's supposed to be at work, because he's going to think you're crazy, you know? So you have to think about, you know, let's talk about some of the things that will work with your lifestyle. And then you're going to have to address that unfavorable impression of dialysis. So this third ask about negotiating the content, this may not be something that's necessary to do, but sort of feeling out the situation, sometimes it is appropriate. And that goal is, you know, determining the type of information they want to hear, determining how they want to hear the information, and eliciting any fears or concerns. And that second, determining how they want to hear the information, is particularly relevant in some cultural differences. You know, sometimes if you know the culture that you're working with, you want to verify that someone, you know, that families have a way of communicating, that's really good to confirm at this time. So again, just a few examples. determining what kind of information he wants to hear. It sounds like you're concerned about needing dialysis. Would it help to hear about what to expect in the next months? Determining how they'd like to hear the information. Based on our previous interactions, it seems like you're the kind of person who prefers hearing statistics rather than general information. Do I have that correct? And then lastly, eliciting fears and concerns. It sounds like finances are a concern of yours. Is there anything else that looking forward that worries you? That way you know more about him and what he's worried about. So when you're telling the information, it's important, of course, to be straightforward, to provide information in short, digestible chunks. And then lastly, of course, avoiding medical talk. And then to finish up, the last ask is, you know, talking, just making sure that what you said makes sense to the patient and that they're understanding. So the ask is, you know, I've just delivered a bunch of new information. What are your thoughts? Or tell me what you're going to tell your wife about this visit when you get home today. Or what questions do you have? So in this way, you're not making the provider, or you're not making the patient, you know, sound like you're trying to quiz what he knows, but you can get an idea of what he's heard from what you said. The second case that I'll talk about is pretty straightforward. So this is Ms. Williams, who later in the day, you're making rounds at your hemodialysis unit. You stop by and see Ms. Williams. She's 75. She's been on hemodialysis for 6 years. And you note she's been hospitalized 3 times in the last 4 months. The last admission was 2 weeks ago for a cardiac arrest of unclear etiology. And you're hoping to finish up in 5 minutes because you have an obligation, an hour, and a lot of dictation to do. So you go by and you say, "How are you doing?" And she said, "I'm terrible. I honestly don't see the point of doing anymore." And I put this case up here because this is something that I see all the time, and I see in really interesting ways of sort of dealing with this patient. But I will say that please pay attention to these comments, because this sometimes can just be a patient saying, "I really just want to express myself," and they're actually doing okay. They're just, you know, they just like to express how they are, you know. And sometimes this is kind of a call for help. And I want, also, I would like to illustrate that this doesn't have to take 3 hours to go through this, okay? So the points that I want to make from this is a couple of things. So sometimes you're like, wow, you're kind of taken away from a comment. One way to deal with it is just asking for more information. Secondly, is that, you know, I have been so surprised almost every day about how effective just being silent is for a patient. Sometimes I don't have to do anything, I don't have to say anything. You just sit there and they just say everything and they ask everything, and it's very effective. And then lastly is kind of just to illustrate that you can't do anything for anyone until you've acknowledged and responded to patients and their family and their emotions. Because if they're dealing with something and you try to talk with them, they're just not listening to what you're saying. So for this woman, I would say, you know, "Tell me more." I'd sit down and I'd say, "Tell me more." And she says, "I feel terrible. All I do is sleep, and then I go to dialysis. I don't have the energy to do anything, and I hate living like this." And you're like, "Oh, that sounds terrible." So, how do you deal with this? And I think it's, again, really important to kind of listen to her and important to respond to the emotions that she's just said. So this is the point that I'll do next, is using this sort of responding to emotions mnemonic, which is common and you've probably heard of. Acronyms NURSE, standing for naming, understanding, respecting, supporting, and exploring. So naming, you know, something like, sounds like you're frustrated. Understanding is not, you can say, I honestly try to stay away from saying I understand that what it feels like to be in your situation, because you really don't. You don't know what it's like to be her. But you can say, I can't imagine what it must feel like to be in your situation. That way she's getting that you're getting it. Thirdly is respecting, and I think this is important to say that this is a verbal and nonverbal, so nodding your head and making sure that your body language is paying attention to her. These are excellent questions, and I'm glad we're talking about this. and then supporting. I want you to know that we're all here for you and we want the best for you. And exploring is, you know, you've been through a lot in the last few months. Tell me how you and Bob have been doing with all this. So what you say is, I'm really glad you brought this up. It sounds like we should talk more about how things are going for you. I want to be able to dedicate more time to this discussion than I have right now. Is it okay if I come back on Wednesday and we can talk further? I think it'd be really helpful if Bob can be part of the discussion as well. So that way you've sort of acknowledged her emotions, you've acknowledged that she's having a tough time, and then hopefully if there's more that she wants to talk about, you've involved the surrogate decision maker. So lastly, I just want to talk briefly about how palliative care might be helpful to your practice. So the subjects, I think, are similar to shared decision making, the really tough medical decision makers, decisions that we're making, you know, choosing, especially number one, I highlight, choose between renal replacement therapy and non-dialytic management of progressive kidney disease, and especially in older patients with comorbidities, because there's more and more evidence that demonstrates that these patients may not benefit from being on dialysis. And so we really, really need to spend some time on these conversations. And involving palliative care may be a good solution for you if you feel uncomfortable doing this. Secondly is addressing or readdressing goals of care and code status. Advanced care planning, end-stage renal disease, patients that are in the ICU, if they're there for more than a couple of days, these are sick patients, and a lot of the times it can be really helpful to involve palliative care. If you're talking about withdrawing or withholding dialysis in the acute or chronic setting, if there's difficult dynamics between the providers and the patients and their family, and then anytime you're having difficulties with symptom management. So lastly, I want to say, when do I involve palliative care? It's important to know that wherever you are, the palliative care resources are different. I tried to explore a bit what might be available here, but it very much depends on the institution and depends sometimes on the insurance that the patient has. So sometimes it takes a little bit to figure out what's available to the patient, but it's getting to know that will be helpful to sort of guide that question of when to involve palliative care. If outpatient palliative care is available to the patient, I'd say use us when you get stuck or when time is an issue. Keeping in mind that most outpatient services do not take on pain management for CKD ESRD patients, but they will make recommendations if you're needing help. And then inpatient palliative care, anytime, like I said, that there's sort of some sort of acute event, if there's an ICU patient who's on dialysis, this is a high marker of mortality, and then whenever outpatient palliative care is not available to the patient and you really think that they could have benefited from that and they happen to be in the hospital, and call us when they're in the hospital. And that's how I'm going to end the talk. Thank you very much for your time.
Non-availability of services. You know, our ability to do dialysis in rural areas massively exceeds our ability to provide other types of care, often even good primary care, specialty care of the traditional ilk, and certainly no availability of palliative care or any of these other support systems. And it is, while I appreciate everything you say and congratulate you on it, it is very geographic. And as I sit in the Bay Area, where I was educated and used to work, you know, I always grieve that what's available here is not available in other locations where I've worked.
I hear you with that one. And I think my exposure with that has been in a veterans hospital setting, where they do have lots of patients that love to live in the middle of nowhere. And so what I would say is that there is a huge move towards sort of, you know, doing telehealth services, which I think is really a great idea for palliative medicine. And it seems like people are more and more moving towards that. So maybe that's a little hope for you, is that you know, this is something that more and more people are sort of talking about and making available, especially in areas where, you know, these services aren't available. But other than that, I hear you, and that's really frustrating.
Sara, yeah, following up on your comments and the question, what would that look like? What would a palliative care telemedicine consult look like? And would it be one session or several and with different groups? Or do you have any experience or knowledge of what that looks like?
I think generally what it how it looks is that there's sort of an initial visit with someone, it may be a nurse or a social worker, to see, you know, what exactly is needed for the patient, and then sort of after that initial session, figuring out how to best provide whatever is needed, whether that be a talk with a physician or, you know, speaking with someone regarding whatever resources are available. It's very patient dependent, and some people may just need one visit and some people may need many visits. So I think that someone kind of expedites what's needed and then helps provide those services. Yeah.
You mentioned the choosing wisely. What has the receptivity in the nephrology community about this recommendation? Is anybody tracking efforts to really support and make that recommendation real?
I would say that in terms of the reception to the Choosing Wisely campaign, I can't talk about the sort of community practice because I don't know the answer to that. But I do. It seems like in academics, people seem to be aware. It is sort of a very generalized statement, and so it's not particularly very controversial. If, you know, because people think they know what shared decision making means. And so I don't, as far as I know, I don't think that particular like number five recommendation is being tracked in any way, because I can't think of a way that it might be tracked. But I think, you know, providers, and from what I've seen in general, are aware. I don't know about the community reception in general, but it seems that people seem to be aware of this.
I can add a couple of things.
Yeah.
By history. Number one. You all should know that the first conference on what we call shared decision making, making decisions about end of life care, dealing with difficult patients in dialysis, the whole gamut, the first conference was held in 1977, before maybe some of you were born. And I really am here today partly to represent my specialty, because I am very aware that this history is lost. And I would bet, Sara, that you don't know that.
I'm happy that you're here to tell us.
The other two seminal documents that came out, and it's now been many years ago, sadly enough, but two, the American, or the Renal Physicians Association, did a document called Withholding and Withdrawing Dialysis, which is the starting or not starting and the stopping, and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, as part of their a big consortium that talked about multiple disease states, cardiac, cancer, etc., also published a document on dialysis and the, what we at that time were calling the ethical and decision-making issues surrounding the continued care, initiation, and discontinuation of dialysis. I don't know that you can get all of those documents anymore, very frankly. My home is a repository of everything. But this is something that historically the nephrology community has talked about since its inception. Dr. Scribner, the founder, father of dialysis, so to speak, discussed them even before that at various conferences. So we are not unaware of this, that the issues continue to evolve. what we thought we addressed years ago has now come back because the technology has changed and the community has changed. And I'm sitting here listening to you and knowing that people in this audience don't understand that keeping people on dialysis is a financially positive thing for physicians. And the community at large in healthcare as a profit-making community likes to have every dialysis chair filled. So I would just say those two things to put some of this in context if you don't mind. Thank you.
Just going back to the palliative care side of things, what in your opinion qualifies for palliative care consult for a patient? Not necessarily related to the SRT.
Are you talking about in the outpatient setting or inpatient setting? I would say, you know, there's so many things that qualify, but anytime that, you know, you think that, you know, the things that qualify are, if you feel like there should be more communication about, you know, how the patient is doing and what the expectations are in the future, that's a great time to call us. If you feel like the patient's symptoms are not adequately controlled and they're suffering, please call us. If the patient asks or their family asks for palliative care, please call us. If the nurse is saying, hey, we really should involve palliative care, please call us. We come in and often just provide a supportive role to patients and their families while they're in the hospital, and there may not be any specific questions. And then when they do arise, we've already gotten to know them, and then they know us and they trust us. Yeah. Yes,
one more question.
I'm sorry?
Go right ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah.
That one statistic of 61% of the patients saying they wish they never started dialysis, do you have any, what the reasons behind that, what reasons they gave?
No,
is it a lack of information, or, you know, yeah, if I knew what I was getting into, I'd never done this kind of thing? Or?
Yeah, I actually have asked Sara Davidson for the survey because that number kind of stood out. I said, can I see that survey? And it essentially just says, I regret my decision to start dialysis, yes or no. And there's no follow-up questions.
That would seem useful to have some follow-up.
I don't think that she expected such a large sort of yes. So that's how surveys go sometimes.
Sure.
Okay, thank you guys.
Thank you so much.